For him, you know, my quota of Sanskrit shlokas are over. So I'll just use some Hindi couplet. Kar khudi ko buland itna, I mean every one of you know. Kar khudi ko buland itna, ki har tabdeer se pehle, khuda bande se puche, bata teri raza kya hai. And this is what he asked Tulsian ji in the morning, aaj market kya karna hai? Ya aage market kya rahega? So friends, I mean, who does not know him? And especially this audience, I don't think any one of you need his introduction. Your day start with Tulsian ji being on CNBC, and as many times as you can afford to look at the TV, you try and look for his views on the television for your decisions in the stock market, whether short time or long term, but mostly on fundamentals. Work hard, do good, and lead a modest and simple life. That's the philosophy of this gentleman who's there with us this evening, Shri S.P. Tulsian. A staunch karmyogi, Tulsian ji's name, to reckon with the investors' fraternity in India. A chartered accountant, of course, a commerce graduate from Bombay University, then a chartered accountant, a company secretary. He was awarded with the Poddar Ratna by the R.A. Poddar College in 2010, which has been conferred so far to only 25 Poddarians in the history of the Poddar College. Mr. Tulsian started investing in the stock market right since 1975, and I think I know him personally little 10 years little later from then, I think 1985-86, and mostly many a times we used to meet during those 94 to 98, those small public issues times when he used to write a lot about the public issue in that premium newspaper, and fundamentally a very, very strong analysis even in those days of the IPOs. We used to compete with some of the writings in Times of India by Mr. Fernando and some other journalists in those days. That's what I remember. As I said, his quotes are looked forward. He has got in-depth knowledge of, I think I can guess, about more than 1,500 to 2,000 listed companies in India. He can talk without looking on the computer about any of those companies. And his number crunching is so well and so efficient in making the number predict the future. I would not like to take much of your time, because if I speak about him, I mean it may take another 1 or 2 hours talking about his intellectuals and his ability to speak this talk, because he breathes talk, he eats stock, I think, and sleeps also with the stocks. With this, ladies and gentlemen, I present before you this evening Shri S.P. Tulsian, and request him to kindly give his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashok, for kind words. Eminent dignitaries on the dais, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Let me, because I won't be going into the direct tax provisions and the capital market, but you know, the few things which are really worrying the market, or which what we have seen in these last 2 days, because generally, before you come to listen to any experts, you know, probably you get the indications whether the market is good or bad, because we all, you know, hooked up to the Sensex and Nifty movement. If it goes up, then we say, budget kafi achha tha. And if it goes down, then we say, dam nahi hai isme, kuch maja nahi hai, bekar hai budget. So I won't, you know, I'll detach myself from this index movements and all that. But if I just need to, I'll call it as a very pragmatic growth-oriented budget. But yes, it has severe weaknesses also, which Ramdevji has, you know, explained, and I'll little, because that is what I have been saying in my last 3 lectures, which I had at the various places, you know, criticizing this DDT, where again the typical bureaucratic tinkering has happened and how damaging that is going to be in the time to come. I'll come little later on that. But many of the allocations, you know, which we see in the, having made in this budget. Firstly, let me come to the expectations. We have all seen the firebrand campaigning, you know, done by the Narendra Modi. So I won't call it as Arun Jaitley budget. This is definitely the budget of Narendra Modi. Because this is, I have in fact said on the day of counting that there has been a change in promoter of the PSU stocks. Earlier, Manmohan Singh was promoter and now the Narendra Modi has become the promoter. And see the valuations, you know, sometimes we see the company changing hands from one promoter to another and then see the valuations, you know, going or hitting the sky. The classic case has been again of United Spirits Limited, which Ramdevji has given you an example when it was with Vijay Mallya a couple of years back, or maybe 3 years back, it was ruling at 400. Now it is with Diageo, it is ruling at 2400, 6x. So I think you have that effect, you know, you have that what you call Midas touch of a person, which we have seen in case of Narendra Modi when he came in into the power, or when people have started expecting him to come into the power. So that kind of firebrand or that kind of Modism has not seen in this budget. See, budget is very good. What I'll say that I won't go into all the items where, you know, I'll just pick up one or two items as a case study and more on the banking recapitalization, where a lot of apprehensions have been expressed by the experts on this electronic media in these last 2 or 3 days. But if you really see the total allocations, they are all ultimately be leading to the good growth. May not be seen in this 1 year, but definitely it will be seen in the next couple year or maybe in the next 3 years. So it will be wrong to call them as a socialistic or populist. Because generally if you see the first budget of the new government are always praised by everyone. Why I'll say everyone? Because populist measures are always missing from that budget. Populist measures will come in the fourth budget of Narendra Modi. Even he will not be an exception. And generally, you know, the people, whether you talk of corporates, you talk of the superpower lobby people, you know, those who have been into that lobby or, you know, who keep the good rapport, networking, they can't afford to criticize the budget, you know. They will always say, budget looks very good. Even if you have increased the excise duty on certain industry and if you ask that promoter, he'll say it is a pass-through. And we won't get affected, and this is a very good budget. So generally, the first budget of any government never gets criticized. But as I said, that a lot of allocations has been made in the budget on the developments, on the growth, on the projects. I'll quickly take them up one by one. But the entire amount, you know, he's banking on, or, you know, to get mobilized from FDI and the local investors. But have we kept them happy? Is our local investor happy with the stock market provisions or the treatment which he is getting? No. Take the case of dividend distribution tax. What is all this tinkering? Your present market cap is about 90 lakh crore, one and a half time of the GDP. Now, 2% generally is taken as a dividend yield. That, you know, ballpark we take that 2% is the yield in this market, because some of the stocks may be having a yield of 5-6%, some of them are having 0.5%, 1%. So take average about 2% dividend yield. That gives you 1,80,000 crore as dividend. What have you done on that? You have increased the dividend distribution tax, which is now sub 17%, 16.995 to 20.50. And you have reduced the receipt in the hands of the promoter, or sorry, the shareholder by 2.9%. And you are saying that no, because we think or we presume that dividend should be grossed up. I'm unable to understand this logic. If you really take the average corporate tax, it is not more than 22 to 24%. So you have imposed double taxes. Company in the first place, there are companies who are paying the maximum 33% tax, and there are many companies which are paying MAT of 18%, which are eventually get utilized against the future profit gets adjusted. So ballpark, the average rate comes to about 24-25% for the corporates, anywhere 22 to 25%. You have imposed the second, this one. See the alternative. What the alternative you have? If you have had a partnership firm, all the partners, the profit would have got taxed at the maximum marginal tax rate in the hands of the partnership firm, then that profit which would have got distributed amongst the hands of the partner would have been tax-free. What is the difference in this? Okay, you want to say that dividend should be taxed. Shift this dividend from corporate to shareholder. Because see, FIIs or the multinational companies, they take the highest dividend payout ratio is seen in the MNC's stocks. Sometimes you see the dividend payout ratio as high as 80%. If you include the dividend distribution tax, in many of the cases, I found that to be 90% plus. The net dividend 70-75%, the grossed up amount is about 90%. So foreigners, you know, they don't recognize the dividend, they don't get credit for dividend distribution tax in their country, because their country says that this is the tax you have not paid, the corporate company has paid. So they are very fussy about this, let me tell you. And 3%, as I said, that shareholder who will be getting the dividend, who is getting a dividend of 10 rupees now in the new regime, will be getting a dividend of now in 9 rupees 71 paisa instead of 10 rupees earlier. So he will be getting a lower dividend of about 2.9%. That means you have increased your dividend receipt by about 6,000 crore on an annual basis. Now what you want to do, you are depending to a great extent, in fact I would say billions of dollars to come in from the foreign investors and the local investors. So I think that this is a bureaucratic tinkering. In fact, I had a talk with a couple of people also, you know, those who have been very close to ruling party. And they've assured that probably government is giving a thought and they are going to remove this dividend distribution tax. I hope that sanity prevails upon the government, or at least Arun Jaitley looks into the matter and this goes to the knowledge of the top think tank also at BJP and they remove this. Second, you know, negative what I have found is the super rich tax that has not been rolled back. That was brought in by the Chidambaram. He had categorically said that this is only for 1 year. And during interim budget when he has presented, he said that is the job of the new government. I can't roll this back in the interim budget. Fine, because that was the legal situation standing at that point of time. But that has not been reversed. So again, you know, you should not, sometimes it is breach of the promissory estoppel. You know, there is a legal word that you have made some promise and you are going back on that promise. So this again, I think is quite negative. And the third thing what I have observed, you know, this is the old practice. See the bureaucratic touch, you know, given into this budget. This has been the practice in the past when the figures were not online, you can't compile the data and all that. When you are presenting the budget in the month of June or July, this happens every fifth year, because now the cycle for the re-election has been set in the month of May, unless and until some midterm election happens in the month of what you call maybe June, July and all sort of things. So always you have this phenomenon that every fifth budget is presented in the month of June. As a financial analyst, I will definitely be expecting the actual number for the financial year which has got concluded, that is FY14. Now if I go by the tax revenues for any item, corporate tax they have shown as 2013-14 revised estimates. They have given the collection of corporate tax as 393,677 crore. This is the identical amount which was there in the interim budget also. And now if you go and check this item, this is not going to be there. This is way below this figure which they have given for FY14 in the final budget which they have presented in the month of July. See, as a financial analyst, we expect all the companies to present the data by 15th May or 31st July. That is the last date of why government cannot do this, why they can't present the data. So if I'm taking a call that, okay, the increase in the corporate tax has been shown a rise of 17.74%. So my base itself is misleading. In fact, my actual receipt for FY14 is not 393,677 crore. Same thing has happened with the service tax. 1,64,927 crore is not the receipt what they have been showing in the FY14 numbers. So sometimes, you know, you are not able to take a call whether the revenue estimates are right or not. I have been hearing all the people, you know, they are saying that, okay, the revenues are very much on the higher side. Now, if you really ask me, if I presume that the data which they have given for FY14 are presumed to be correct, I don't dispute, though I know that they are not correct. They are way below what has been presented. The actuals are much lower what they have presented. I will say that they have shown a growth of 14.56% in the corporate tax. I am quite convinced with that kind of rise. Because if you are estimating a GDP of close to 5.4 to 5.9%, I am little optimistic because I am always an optimistic person. I say that 6% will be the GDP growth. 6% take or 6.5% take as inflation. Your nominal GDP growth is 12-13%. 12.5 to 13%. You can very well achieve a growth of 14.5% in the corporate tax. Similar is the case with the individual. They have estimated a growth of 17.6%. They had a growth of 20% last year when the situation was so bad. Things were at its lowest, you know, in the terms of the sentiments. Last year was the worst. And that is the reason that super rich tax has come at that point of time. Similar is the case with service tax. If you take the base 13-14 as correct, they have estimated a growth of 31%. I say even in case of 31% growth in service tax is right. Because we have an inflation of about 12-13%, which are largely affecting all the services. So, inflation is never reflected into the agricultural growth, industrial growth, customs growth, excise growth. But that is very much reflected into the service tax. Because they are all directly impacted. Maybe in case of services, the inflation is much more what you have a nominal GDP growth. So if you have a nominal GDP growth 12-13%, you expect that services will be having an inflation of about 15-16%, and you have a normal growth of about 15-16%. So you have double advantage, double effect. I've in fact seen talking many of the people that, okay, the 31% service tax is very high. But if you calculate that with the actual receipt, what government has earned for FY14, this revised estimates works out to a growth of 38%. So I have my doubts, you know, that the figures which they've given for FY13-14, I think are erroneous, are misleading. In fact, they should have given the correct figure for FY13-14. Now come on the brighter side. Because since we are all into the market, you know, some of the things are really bothering us, whether these things are achievable or not. Now in case of the subsidy, people have been very negative on that as well. Because I'm not going into the direct tax provisions because that has been nicely explained and presented by Punamiyaji. In case of the subsidy, they have estimated fertilizer subsidy of 73,000 crores, 72,970. In my view, that is very much achievable. Why? Because government has said that they are going to revamp or restructure the urea policy. Now, urea is largely misused by the farmers for the simple reason that they get urea at 5,600 rupees per kg, and on that the government is paying a subsidy of 12,000. That means the cost of the urea is 18 rupees per kg, which is available to the farmer for 5,600 rupees per ton. So they say that because of the excess use of the nitrogen, in urea you have nitrogen and you need potassium and you need potash, which comes into the complex fertilizer. So if they restructure that, if they educate the farmers properly, because that has been their focus, this 73,000 crore subsidy can very well be brought down to 65,000 crore. If not in this year, at least in the next year. Similar is the case with the petroleum subsidy. I'm not touching the food subsidy, 1,15,000. That also seems to me on a reasonable side. Come on the petroleum subsidy, they have provided for 63,426 crore as the net exchequer burden after netting off the contributions to be received from the upstream. What was the subsidy for FY14? Diesel had 63,000 crore, kerosene had 30,000 crore, and LPG had 45,000 crore. So your net subsidy was 1,40,000 crore. Gross subsidy was 1,40,000 crore. 67,000 crore was contributed by the upstream company. So net subsidy burden was 73,000 crore. As against that, they have provided 63,426 crore. I think that this is very much achievable because the staggered price hike of diesel of 50 paisa per year, per month, has started last year. And practically in this year, the subsidy burden on diesel may not be more than 20-25,000 crore, which was at 63,000 crore last year. So I don't think that we need to have any kind of, you know, apprehensions and reservations largely on that account. Maybe tax collections seem to be on the higher side, the estimates which they have given, but I think on the subsidy, we need not be too panicky, because crude, if you really see the Iraq situation, that has not really spoiled the crude picture also. Now, you know, the next discussion which I have been seeing is the Basel III norms for the PSU banks. You have all been hearing that that the banks will be required to have 2,40,000 crore to get injected into the 24 PSU banks by 2019. We have to implement the Basel III by 31st March 2019. You have 5 years from here on. Now it looks obviously 2,40,000 looks a Himalayan figure. How can you have this kind of amount? From where this will come? And more specifically, when only 11,500 crore has been provided by the government in this budget towards the recapitalization. In this interim budget, they have provided 11,200 crore. And minister has said, finance minister, that we are depending on the retail common investors. We will be mobilizing that kind of money from retail investors. Now, if you really see the present situation, I'm giving you the data of 24 listed banks. The market cap of those 24 banks was 3,78,000 crore on valuations as of Friday closing. Now, if the government wants to bring down their holding to 51%, they can sell the excess stake which they are holding in these banks, which will give them 44,834 crore. But in case of the banks where the stake of the government has to be brought down to 51%, it will never be a divestment. It will be infusion of the fresh equity in the bank, because eventually you have to raise the capital of the bank to meet the to meet the Basel III norms. Because in Basel III, there won't be tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 kind of capital. There will only be one. So if you just double this amount, because if you are selling and if you are infusing, the government can mobilize 85,000 crore by bringing down their stake from the bank in these banks to 51%. Now they will continue to allocate about 11,000 crore every year in these banks. That is what I presume. That gives 55,000 crore. 85,000 crore for plus 55,000 crore, it gives 1,40,000 crore. If you have, you know, you expect, Ramdevji has said that, you know, this stock market gives you a return of 18-20%, which we have already seen that kind of thing happening. I presume that maybe in the next 5 years you have that kind of requirement. So the valuation of 85,000 crore in next 5 years on an average can get raised to about 1,40,000 crore. And 55,000 crore to be infused by the government in the bank, the matching amount can come there also. So see, 140, 55 plus 55, this all figure looks little complicated. But you can easily mobilize 2,50,000 crore. You have to create the conducive atmosphere for that. But can you rely 2,40,000 crore, or can you do you have the reputation of collecting that kind of money from the overseas investor and from the retail investors? No. Because for the simple reason, as I said, if you really see the department or the harassment, in fact, I interact with many small investors, they are not legitimately given the benefit of short-term capital gain and long-term capital gain tax. So many appeals are, I am unable to understand that poor guy has paid delivery security transaction tax. The moment he is paying security transactions tax on delivery basis, that means he is investor. And this department, you know, is unlawfully harassing and treating that as a business income. And believe me, I have been talking to so many people, they all ran away from the market. They say, hell with your this market. Because we have all provided, we have taken legitimately as the long-term capital gain, short-term capital gain. Department assess that as a business income. And then they put interest and then they put levy. And the assessment gets completed in 4 years, 5 years. Poonamiyaji has given the reference of Gopal Purahit judgment. But how much, go and see this one. So why government has not been categorical in saying that if you have paid the delivery STT, you are rightfully entitled to claim that as a short-term capital gain and long-term capital gain. I don't think that you can just set the ambitious target. You know, see, the justice done should be seen that justice has been done. You just can't say that I've done the justice. It should be seen that, yes, justice has been done. So government, you know, has not given the an eye to the pain which is faced by the local investor. Come on the foreign investors. Again, this GAR issue has started haunting the market. I agree that GAR is not going to get implemented. But see, market is impulsive, you know, because they say a clear roadmap. They want that I can't wind up my affairs and my establishment just in 1 month. For some reason, on 28th February 2015, if you don't roll back the GAR by another couple of years, or you don't hold it, then we won't be able to go away in next 1 year. So in next 1 month, so you know, so the situation, because already if you see the treaty is covering only three countries, Cyprus, Mauritius and Singapore. Cyprus already is under fire. Government has issued the notice for Cyprus, so that is coming to an end. Mauritius, they are already in the process of renegotiation. In case of Singapore, it is linked to the Mauritius, because Singapore treaty says if you are continuing with the Mauritius treaty, whatever gain is available to you will be available to you in the Singapore also. So it is two-legged race. It is connected with the Singapore, connected with the Mauritius treaty. So you have given them a good leeway, good ground that, okay, all your income will be treated as capital gain, whether it is long-term or short-term. If it is short-term, 15%. If it is long-term, it is 10%. But there are many FIIs who are operating from UK, from US. They say that we don't have any principal place of business here in India. We don't have fund manager. We don't have office. We don't have any contact. We just operate from there. And they are coolly operating without paying any tax. Okay, people all across the world, they want clarity, they want peace of mind. They are not averse to paying a short-term capital gain tax of 15% and long-term capital gain tax of 10% if they have the peace of mind, if they have the clarity. But that must be spelt out. You cannot put your legislation problems before them that, okay, this all will get carried out in the budget of 2015. Because they say that we don't trust you. We don't trust you. In the past, if you can strike down the judgment of the apex court, how can we trust you that these kind of assurances will be given? So believe me, take the case of bullet train. We have all been talking. I have been going through the data. 120 crore per kilometer. Bombay to Ahmedabad, 500 kilometer. You will be requiring 60,000 crore, $10 billion. Who has that kind of money to put in? And they will be charging a fare of 5 rupees per kilometer, because the viability of the bullet train will not get established unless and until you charge a fare of 5 rupees per kilometer. That means the ticket rate will be 2,500 rupees. People will say, why should I travel by the bullet train? So, you know, sometimes your intentions, which are very genuine, which are very clear, and vis-a-vis bullet train, 120 crore per kilometer, vis-a-vis high-speed trains, you know, that costs only 2 crore per kilometer for upgradation of the railway track. We are fine with having what you call the high-speed trains, which will be having a peak speed of 200, 220 kilometer with average speed of 150 kilometer. If you want to have the pan-India, this bullet train, if I just measure the length east, north to south and east to west, it will be about 3,000 kilometer minimum. Do we have that kind of money? So the conducive atmosphere, the bureaucratic tinkering, you know, need to be looked into, which I think has not been done by this finance minister. But yes, we have to give him the doubt, because he has been holding two important portfolio, defense and finance. So he may not have that time. But the way they have straightened the approach, the bureaucracy, I think they need to look into, because if you can pull up your socks during the campaign, you know, you can make it so deep-rooted. You need to check all these things, because this cannot really make the capital market vibrant and conducive for the investors. You are scaring them. At one time, 12% of the saving used to come into the stock market. Now it is less than 1.5%. Saving rate as such has fallen from 36% to sub 30%. So if you really see, India is more a savings economy. You know, we are not thriving on the expenditure economy. We are more a savings economy. So what my point is that a lot needs to be done to restore the confidence in the minds of the local investor and foreign investors. Let me just... Now let me come quickly on the market part, that where I see the potential, I think, because otherwise if I don't give that, probably, you know, See, I'm very bullish on MNC companies, because the kind of approach, see this dividend distribution tax and, you know, all sort of things, that dividend distribution tax will continue to remain there. I'm not saying that merely by delisting they can escape from that. But otherwise also, you know, rupees strengthening and all that, MNC companies are looking very good, because you have that comfort. You are still buying the shares, you know, which are available at a P multiple of 25 to 30 times. And even if they don't initiate a delisting move, I think that will be a quite positive in the time to come. Because if you will be having an overall PE expansions, they always rule at 2x of the general market PE multiple. So MNCs look, again, very good. Some of the stocks could be GlaxoSmithKline Consumer, Glaxo Pharma, Ingersoll Rand, Castrol, Goodyear, Timken, and all sort of things. Next, I'm very bullish on the natural resources and more specially the natural resources which are held by the PSUs. And only three companies comes to my mind, that is ONGC, Coal India and NMDC. Because if you really see the kind of, you know, expansion, coal minister is talking of employing a private sector CEO for Coal India. And he has, you have seen the new mines got opened with a production of 12 million ton. Somebody may question what does this 12 million ton will make a difference, because they are having a production of 450 million ton. So 12 million ton is nothing. But that is the mindset, you know, they are going with. So if you have the increase in production, the marginal costing principle, because they are largely loaded with the fixed cost concept, the variable cost margins are very high. So these three companies can really gain a lot. Then I'm very bullish on the cement sector, because the kind of capacity, you have not seen any kind of capacity addition having taken place in this last 3 years. Whatever projects have all been initiated, they are only getting completed. Consolidation is happening, and the kind of cement requirement, they are talking of 100 smart cities, they are talking of the infrastructure, they are talking of the housing, everywhere, and cement can't get imported. We don't have that logistic, we don't have that port facilities. So cement really is going to, and one can pick the, we all know the names of the company, Ambuja, Ultratech, the bigger one, the smaller one, everyone is going to enjoy that. Then I'm very bullish on NBFCs, you know, because of the kind of rural income growth which we'll be having, and the way they are penetrated. So again, keep an eye on NBFCs. Power stocks are again, you know, obviously Poonamiyaji has said that the power generation, transmission and distribution, they have given a tax holiday window extended for another 10 years. So that is again very positive. Port itself is very positive, and there are very few companies, you know, those who are employed in the port. Again, Ramdevji has given you an example of Gujarat Pipavav Port Limited. Adani Port is again one of them. I won't include the other this thing. Then shipbuilding industry has been given a big thrust, because they have said that inland water transportation and all that. So one can keep an eye on the port and shipbuilding companies. Automobile again looks very good, and prominent amongst them are more like M&M, Maruti, Tata Motors and Ashok Leyland. And last is the housing finance company, because the kind of increase, the tax rebate from 1,50,000 to 2 lakh, though it is, you know, people were expecting even to the relief to come in the loan repayment also, which is at 1 lakh rupees, to get extended by to 1,50,000. But never mind. So these are the few companies. And again, you know, if I request everyone, in fact that has been my advice since this government won and came into the power, stick to the quality stock, because otherwise after 2 years down the line, you know, when you will see your demat statement, probably you will find NFL, FSCT, MTNL kind of stocks. You know, I'm not trying to say that they are not good, but please, you know, remain away from that. Must have an asset allocation within the stock market allocation also. Keep 60% at least in the quality stocks, which I'm not going by the A group, B group, C group, but they are all quality stocks. 20% could be in the mid cap. Play off your 10% of the amount, you know, with these kind of stocks, you know, where you every day see 10% upper circuit, 20% upper circuit kind of things. But discipline must be brought in while investing in this market, because this is a long play. You know, you are going to see the economy now taking off from here, and that process, in my view, will continue maybe for 10 or 15 years. So with this, I end my discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Tulsian ji.